We are going to talk about my favorite world tomorrow, the ground rules of this panel, and most of the speakers here have prepared for it. The ground rules were a realistic projection of the future in a time span somewhere between 50 and 100 years. Longer if they felt like it. But the optimistic projection. Now that may turn out if you're very pessimistic, but your optimistic one still looks pretty black. But the idea was, where can we get to realistically that you would really kind of like to be, or at least better than any of the others? There have been some substitutions, additions, and subtractions, for which I must apologize. Fred Pohl, as you know, was put onto the panel Friday because he had to get back to New Jersey today. It turns out airline schedules out of Kansas City are not as plentiful as one might have supposed. And to get to smaller cities, airline connections are such that many people had to leave this morning. The same is true, I am sorry to tell you, of Mr. Van Vogt. That short gentleman with the beard is not Mr. Van Vogt, despite his superficial resemblance to him. If you've ever seen Van, he's taller than I am, and he looks a bit like my sergeant, and the earth moves as he walks and so forth. So Mr. Van Vogt, as you know, his wife died about a year ago, and he is visiting relatives up in Canada, and this is the only opportunity he'll have to see some of them. And again, there was no way he could get up to somewhere in the interior of Canada. I think they take dog sleds, and the RCMP escorts them and so forth. You know what RCMP are. Those are dorsai with red uniforms. And the little string on the pistol. Anyway, we have, instead of Mr. Van Vogt, we have Carl Flock, who is the editor of Libertarian Review, and whose views may be interesting. Our other speakers are Spider Robinson, who Spider Robinson is, whose column, Spider versus the Hacks of Saul 3, is trying to slowly winnow the chaff away from the real grain in the science fiction business. Next to him, we have Mr. Arson Darnay, and that's really his name. My Lord, I would wish I could have been born with a name like. Have you ever seen a name that looks better in print than that? Arson Darnay, who is a former government official and of some considerable background in the sciences and particularly administration of scientific programs. Next to him, I've mentioned Carl Flock, the editor of Libertarian Review. And finally, at the end of the panel, the gentleman who found Mr. Darnay's first story in the slush pile. I guess that's what we call it. It's what we always have, but it seems like it can't be a minimum.
Rather than to talk about it ad lib, although the ad lib method is obviously more friendly and is more communicative. But forgive me for reading this to you so that you get the flavor of what I have to say. Imagine a tomorrow where youngsters in their middle teens undergo a very curious conversion experience. They enter lovely, gleaming buildings in special schools. They lie down in strange machines that hold all kinds of electronic and chemical technology. And for a month, they undergo daily training for several hours each day. The rest of the time, they spend in silent isolation. And then after the month is over, it's all over, and the youngsters reemerge into a fragile and complex world. It's exciting, throbbing, glittering and colorful, and rather esoteric. But by now, they have telepathic powers, and they control all manner of extrasensory abilities. Minor miracles are not entirely beyond them, and in a pinch, they can turn water into wine. In extreme situations, they can even leave their bodies and travel long distances in a spirit form, and they have a brand new understanding of the world. They know deep down, and this is not just in their heads, that the universe is a single, stupendous, inexpressible system of energies, and that they are that system. that though they feel separated and are individuals, they are nevertheless really one with one another and with everything else. They know that they are immortal, and although their bodies will eventually die, they know that they are evolving towards some unimaginable form and future. And that the three-dimensional world is just a starting point, the point where matter distills itself into spirit. The world is now radically different from the one we used to know in some respects. The institutions of coercion have disappeared. There are no more armies or churches or political parties or jails or courts or mental hospitals. Ideologies are gone, and so are the external compulsions, whether they are subtle or gross. But not everything has changed. There are still competitions, for instance. The Olympics are alive and well. All manner of grand exhibitions are taking place in dancing, music, painting, science, speculation, technology, acrobatics, and so forth. And these are the highlights of a life filled with intense activity and associations and veritable storms and cataracts and hurricanes of human dialogue of every kind and on every conceivable subject. Even the functions of biological survival have taken on a great deal of verve and excitement. Now, imagine that you are there with your microphone in.
Apparently, your microphone is not turned on and you're not speaking in directly.
Okay. Imagine now that you have a microphone in hand and you're there interviewing people in a city, and it might be an immensely flat place like Los Angeles or a 7-kilometer-high swaying acropolis, or it could be a rural settlement. Or it could be a settlement under the sea. And you're interviewing people who are strolling about, and you're asking them about their current world, but they're not particularly interested in the visible marvels of their time or the social harmonies. They talk mostly about the richness or the leanness of the noosphere. So you're talking now to a female, and you ask her what she's talking about, and she tells you that the planet now generates an envelope of spirit. All men are striving to energize that envelope by ever greater efforts to spiral up the infinite. You try to get an explanation of what the lady has in mind, but it's obvious to you that you don't understand. She screws up her face. She reaches for a simplistic analog and she says, "Back in your day, people talked about choirs of angels." And you nod. Well, she says, "It's like this. The gross energies of the cosmos are running down towards inertia. And the subtle energies of spirit are accumulating." And she looks at you, but you look blank. "Well," she says, "man turns energy into spirit by creative work. You know, in science, the arts, in crafts, in athletics. Great achievements increase the cosmic voltage, and failures create a voltage drop. The noosphere is rich or lean, depending. And when the noosphere is lean, the bodiless communities," she points up to the sky, "the bodiless communities are weakened in their effort, but if the noosphere is rich, you see, then they are strengthened. Then more matter turns into energy, more energy into spirit, and the spiral really moves. Only," she adds, "that way it sounds a little silly and quite different from the way it really is. Look," she says, "why don't you get your head to open up, and then you'll understand it without my telling you in pigeon talk." And so you ask, "Well, how is the noosphere today?" And she says, "Oh, so-so. The geometry jamboree last night in Australia was something flat at best. Millions are going back to fundamentals. More lean than rich right now, I would say. Too bad you can't feel it. It all depends on the nuance of it, you see. And that just can't be put into words. And that just can't be put into words." And so you say, "What do they do when they go back to fundamentals?" And she says, "Well, they sublimate, of course. You know, the jamboree got egotistic on the edges." "Huh? Well, I wish I could explain to you," she says, "but it's just not possible." So this is a very foreshortened view of my favorite world of tomorrow, and now let me tell you how it came to be. We go back to the United States in the 1960s. People are disenchanted with the world. They are shocked by future shock, lamed by technology, alienated by bureaucracy. They reach out for esoteric forms of escape in their misery: science fiction, drugs, religion. Religion above all, especially foreign breeds in strange, outlandish dress, fluent in Sanskrit and in Japanese. Millions of people turn on to LSD, to meditation, and preferably both. Racks overflow with ancient and modern books about the great occult. Mystical texts are turned dog-eared in subways, and women turn to witchcraft, and the level of your consciousness is your status symbol. Even scientists are sucked into this maelstrom by and by. They also take up meditation. They read those peculiar books. A few begin to study phenomena like telepathy, precognition, and reincarnation. In the later 1970s, prestigious institutions have begun to do serious research. A new field combining physiology and psychology and known as biofeedback has emerged into respectability, shaky respectability. Very gingerly at first and then prodded to do it because the Russians are doing it too, the government opens up its funding coffers and then everybody is doing studies on the psychic and on the mystics and on the saints. And then comes a brief lull. Between 1983 and 1991, the three-way war consumes the money and the talents devoted to this effort. That's the war that Mr. Heinlein was talking about yesterday. But 3 years after we signed the Treaty of Chupé and after the economy has settled back to normalcy, the new religious fervor erupts again more virulently than ever. Conditions are dismal, and a super bureaucracy that President Pornell has sworn he will dismantle is still around and pressing us very hard. Then in 1994, Professor Jimmy Joe U. Le Guin, working at MIT, carries out a comprehensive study of the lives of saints, Western, Eastern, and primitive, modern as well as ancient. Masses of data about these eccentrics, their behavior, activities, and teachings, including the miraculous activities associated with their lives, such as the power to levitate, and to bilocate, or the power to appear in more than one place at a time, and their telepathic and other ESP powers are put on a huge computer for analysis. Professor Jimmy Joe presents his findings at the annual meeting of the Society of Astrophysicists because he's an astrophysicist, although his study of the saints, begun as a hobby, has by now completely swamped his prime discipline. He's expelled from the society, but that rash act of indignation is reversed posthumously in 2009. Professor Jimmy Joe says, in effect, the saints, be they Muslim, dervishes, Hindu holy men, Indian witch doctors, or Christian ascetics, all have basic features in common. Whatever their motives, they all did one thing supremely well. They concentrated on a single objective to the exclusion of all others, an inner search after an elusive something. They used their minds, their bodies, and emotions to this end and all achieved some kind of fundamental breakthrough. In the words of the professor, and you can see him with his eyes gleaming behind bifocals, his voice trembling a little as he stands behind a podium, he says, they broke out of the subject-object matrix of our three-dimensional world into some kind of fourth or spiritual dimension. And once they had achieved this breakthrough, they not only saw our world from a new perspective, but they could also act on it from their position miraculously. They are, ladies and gentlemen, analogous to the first apes who had a human kind of intelligence. They are the tip of human evolution. The professor goes further. He suggests that the saints' experience is natural rather than supernatural. They made contact with a single underlying cosmic energy. They spent years in their dull and slightly crazy quest, but they need not have worked so long to reach union with God or samadhi or nirvana or recognition or enlightenment or whatever else. They groveled as long as they did because they were ignorant of the process itself. And the process of breaking through has to do with gaining control over certain autonomous workings of the central nervous system. Jimmy Joe then goes into detail, showing the physiology of the thing on using slides in a darkened conference room. So there's uproar, silent uproar. Astrophysicists are very polite. All they do is they vote to send Jimmy Joe out of their society. But the biofeedback people, reading about all this in Psychology Tomorrow, embrace the heretic professor with enthusiasm. Within 5 years, the first basic training module has been devised and tested. The first volunteers, college students, needless to say, undergo the most rudimentary kind of training, and the rest is history. The first revolution, the one spanning three decades beginning in 2015, culminates in the unopposed military conquest of the United States by United Europe. But the conquerors cannot resist using the training institutes they capture, and thus the technology spreads to Europe and from thence by a similar cycle of conquest and reconquest to the rest of the globe. The experience of those early converts is still recorded in existing literature. Most of these books are marked by an immense astonishment of the authors, reaching the fourth dimension as they did rapidly without long years of devout service to some irrational religious myth, like the saints of old. They were stupefied by the incredible expansion of their knowledge and powers. They become aware of numberless worlds beyond our own, inhabited by disembodied entities organized in endless gradations according to evolutionary achievement and personal predilection. The universe is a single entity. They are identical with it, despite their apparent separation. They refuse to believe intellectually that they are immortal and engaged in an infinite labor, an infinite game of creativity. The unknown beckons, and so does the unformed. They make new knowledge and create ever more complex geometries. They went into training as men filled with the usual fears, and they come out as gods, fearless and eager to experience the world. Only later, after the majority of men have achieved the transformation and the renegade pockets have shrunk to insignificance, does the new problem present itself. The noosphere, predicted by Teilhard de Chardin, the Jesuit naturalist and mystic, becomes perceivable, circling the globe like a bright girdle furled. It's dense with iridescence, it is dense with iridescent Teilhardian phantasma, now rich and now lean. And then the world begins to take on a familiar aspect again. It has its new problem, its new objective. Life takes a new thrust. Utopia on Earth becomes a kind of minimum condition for tackling the next task ahead, which is nothing less than the total spiritualization of the matter of the universe, so that a new cosmos can be fashioned for a new Big Bang.
Well, Arson, we asked you not to be so narrowly technological in these papers, but thank you. We will withhold comments on the papers until they are all done. Carl, are you prepared to speak on the libertarian paradise of the 35th century?
I'm as ready as I'll ever be, which is probably not at all.
But, excellent. Carl Flock.
I woke up this morning to that thunder and lightning that was raging outside. I thought it was our chairman or President Pornell calling me to the panel. And it's unscrambled what little bit, scrambled what little bit I'd unscrambled during those few hours that he gave me to think about this thing. My favorite world tomorrow, today, yesterday, any day, really, would be a world in which anything that's peaceful is okay. As Robert Nozick up at Harvard said, a world in which capitalist acts between consenting adults are not prohibited. A world in which social power, that is voluntary social arrangements between individuals of whatever sort, religious, economic, political, artistic, would be the only really significant social order outside of perhaps what I think of as government, that is the cops, the courts, and the cavalry, perhaps. A very minimal governmental order that would exist for the sole purpose of excluding any non-peaceful activity, any sort of coercive action against one individual against another, a group of individuals against another group of individuals. I like this kind of society simply, well, I had this gut attraction to such a society. It's aesthetically pleasing to me. I'd like to live in one this way. But I also think that it's one that, it's the kind of society which is most likely to assure the continuance of the race. It's the kind of society that would make it possible for endless experiment, endless opportunity for trying new ways to do things, endless possibilities to cope with whatever the unexpected events are that we're likely to run into over the course of our evolutionary history. I think a society like that is a society that's a survival society, a society that allows the individual to deal with his life in his own way, in his own peaceful way, and with his fellows in his own peaceful way, is the kind of society that is capable of surviving almost anything. You think of the rigid societies of the past, you think of the Inca. Lop the head off, and the whole works came down. All the people who lived throughout that society were nothing but simply extensions of the Inca himself, and all it took was Pizarro to get up there and do in the Inca, and that was the end of it. It all came crashing down. A society that is, if you will, a polyglot society in terms of the way people order their existence, the way they deal with each other, is one that's going to be pretty hard to shoot down, I think, it seems to me. How likely is such a society, given the world that we've got today and where we're going? I think not likely, at least on this planet. What have we got? We have the United States moving towards, I think, a brave new world society. We've got the Soviet Union that's the 1984 society. We've got China that is a sort of this perfect day society. And I don't see that there's much room in the interstices for people like myself to maneuver around. But if we can get out there, if we can open up a frontier that'll never end, then the possibilities are, I think, infinite. That may be redundant, I don't know. Well, the switch is on, is it not? Yeah. I'm not, okay, is that, can you hear me now? Okay. I'm sorry. I'm new to this kind of stuff. I usually sit behind a typewriter or use a blue pencil all the time, and human beings sitting in front of me and the microphones and all that kind of thing don't do much for me. Except scare me, that is. Just like the society that the individual, or the single society that I was talking about earlier, the society of social power with a voluntary association, which has a whole range of possibilities for human development and potential. I think a human race that has reached to the stars and has got given itself enough elbow room such that it's likely to be warring with itself much. This Mr. Heinlein's pointed this out a number of times, and I think in Time Enough for Love he suggests that elbow room is far better than a strong police force and a lot of ID cards. I think that's true. It's a race that has gotten itself elbow room, a race that has a whole range of planets on which to develop itself. A race that has the opportunity to organize itself into any kind of social arrangement, a theocracy, a military dictatorship, even for that matter, a completely free libertarian society. A race that has all these possibilities scattered amongst the stars is much more likely to be able to cope with whatever it runs into on whatever front. Than one that is a rigid and structured imperial or bureaucratic arrangement. And however we get to the stars, whether it has to be paid for by taxes that are extracted from me, whether I like it or not, or whether it's done by ITT or whatever, I don't care so long as we get out there, because I think that's what's going to make the difference. I know many of my libertarian friends are going to shoot me for that, for having said that, but I do believe it. And And I really can't say much more because what I need is another drink of beer, and I want to sit back and listen to the other people who are a heck of a lot more prepared than I am in more ways than one. Thank you.
Capacity of technological hard data in these extrapolations of my favorite world of tomorrow. He's right. I feel this would be a lot different panel if, say, Larry Niven were on it, or it would have been a lot different panel if Van and Fred were able to make it. I'm afraid I'm going to continue the tendency. I haven't got much to say about technology.
That's all right. I do.
Good. Well, I just wanted to say that, to my mind, technology, that's like a suntan. You know, when you need it, you'll get it. But the thing about that you got to remember is that if you don't pay attention to it, you're liable to get burned. I feel I must say that it is essential that we all start paying attention. It's just far too late for us to have started paying attention. And the best place that I know to pay attention is a faithful and scrupulous reading of Dr. Pornell's column every month. We need a reporter on the state of the art. In particular, the one that just ran and the one that I understand is running soon. Anyway, plug aside.
Thank you.
Another non-technological favorite world of tomorrow. What else are we all in this racket for, huh? We're trying to build our favorite world of tomorrow. And we're working on the blueprints right now. We're trying to achieve some consensus on how are we going to design this starship? How are we going to build a life support? How are we going to take care of this and that and other? Somebody said to me a couple of days ago, just mentioned the old line that I am not my brother's keeper. I thought about that long and hard, and I don't know if I can agree. I'm trying to pick a science fictional analog here, so we'll get something vaguely technological in. We're all sitting on a starship, okay? And frankly, the vibes on this starship suck. I think we all know that. A lot of us aren't having a good time. And a lot of us are starving to death on the starship because we haven't designed our life support very well. There's low morale. When there's low morale on a starship in which an awful lot of guys are running around with guns capable of holding the hull, we are in big trouble. We are in danger. The nature of the danger, God knows there's been thousands of restatements of the indictment against man, how corrupt and evil we all are, and all that stuff. And that ain't the kind of stories that I like to write, and that ain't the kind of stories I like to read. I've heard that already. I prefer people like Pangborn that forgive us our sins and go on from there. You know, well, okay, what can we do? But I got to kind of put out something that I don't hear much that I feel like I got to say is my favorite candidate for the number one thing that's lousing up our starship. I think we're bloody selfish. Each and every one of us, me and you. When I got here on the airplane, I think they must have designed this whole flight for science fiction fans. The plane, the in-flight magazine, had an article on cars of the future. Oh, it was beautiful. It was one of a stationary car where the city moves past it on a treadmill, so you always have a... solved a parking problem for all time. However, there was also a little throwaway here called Gifts for Your Favorite. TWA Flight Shop. And I started thumbing through this, and boy, you never seen such science fictional gifts. I'd like to read you one or two. Calculator watch. Okay? How more science fictional can you get? Time and space all of it thrown together. A calculator watch. This is one of those light-emitting diode watches, okay? Because they're spiffy. A digital five-function watch gives hours, minutes, seconds, month, and day. So you never have to pay attention to what day it is. There is also a full-function calculator. Adds, subtracts, multiplies, and divides, and features a constant factor, chain calculations, information recall, floating decimal, and 8-digit readout. The watch is a solar cell unit and is powered by exposure to sunlight or incandescent light. Normal wear, however, gives it enough energy to power the timepiece without changing the batteries. By a company called Uranus. I think they deserve a round of applause for the most science fictional toy ever devised. Now, I can imagine people who, in their professional work, could get great use out of a watch like this. There are people, in fact, who should have a watch like this, okay? just because they might need while they're sitting in the bathroom to work out a calculation. However, this thing costs $799.95, and I don't think that there are enough people that need them that bad that we need this more than we need a better way of getting bread out to the hungry guy. There's another one here, the best of both worlds, the Longines watch, which has both a light-emitting diode display and a regular watch face, so that you can read it clearly and easily day or night. The LCD section is a continuous time readout. The LED is you can push a button and get it to repeat what you see in the slot above, should there be total absence of light. 100% solid-state quartz accuracy, 3-year guarantee, $395. There's no point in going on, okay? pleasure. Every way you turn, you can get it by pushing a button. And that's what we're putting our energy into and our time into, is refining, shortening the duration between the time you wish you had a pleasurable sensation and the time you experience it. Now, I gotta say that there's a survival value to pleasure, and that there is a survival value to waste and inefficiency sometimes. That when, as Heinlein says, when you're on a very tight budget, sometimes the luxuries are the things you should budget first to keep a little morale going. But I think we've become addicted. I think we're the most addicted culture the world has ever seen. And when you start working out the mechanics of, well, do I have to have this pleasure enough to justify all the technological input into that, taken away from more important problems? You know, is it important enough for me to eat a steak that some guy should starve because there ain't enough soybeans, because we put, you know, 10 pounds of soybeans to get 1 pound of meat and all that equation? You work that out, you make your own decision. I'm not a vegetarian, I eat meat, and I've come to my own synthesis. But when you do that, you know how when I read in somebody's science fiction story where they were planning a big project, maybe it was Stand on Zanzibar and they were planning Beninia or something, but part of the figures was the projected deaths ratio. They do this in construction too. For every building, you figure out how much money it's liable to cost you, how much time it's liable to take, how many workers are liable to die from accidents, and they get pretty close. You can predict death ratios. It's going to cost us 6 guys to finish this building. And the cultural decision is we need this building enough that 6 guys should fall off by accident. You do that all the time unconsciously without thinking about it. When you decide to eat a steak, you're accepting the possibility that doing that may have starved a guy you'll never meet. You have to do that to live. But it demands extreme care and self-scrutiny all the time. We get an elitism head in science fiction. I've seen it all over the place. The notion that, well, the world might get saved, but it's going to have to be done by some elite figuring out a way to impose rationality and saneness, because we're a planet full of crazy buggers. You know, what we need is some good, efficient government that can see to it that we be good. It's funny, there's no way around it. This starship is run by consensus, unless and until individual crewmen give up their vote. Anybody qualifies as a crewman on the starship. There are no employment qualifications except experience, which is necessary. I'm sorry, science fiction people that believe that we're going to solve it all by escaping to the stars. A careful elite of us, like Heinlein says, that the pioneering few, the enterprising, the brave, and the courageous, will migrate to the stars, and then sometime out there we'll get it right. You know, I can't agree. That's like saying, you know, you're on a lifeboat and there's a bunch of starving people on the lifeboat, but somebody offered you an opportunity to come for a ride on his Chris Craft. You can't jump ship. Not ethically. You can't. I'm sorry. Okay, this leaves us with a problem. This is the point we always get to, everybody always gets to, and here's where we stop. How do we bell the cat? Where do we go from here? How do we make people straighten up? You can't legislate people into being sensible. You can't legislate people into being cool. It's never been done. Never has happened anywhere. At most, you get sort of token appearance of obedience or something. You can't persuade people 9 times out of 10. You can't force people. God is dead, okay? Well, Harlan said in the introduction to Deathbird Stories that we make our own gods just by deciding to believe in them. That when we all agree that God was dead, yeah, there he went. And the story Whimper of Whipped Dogs in particular suggested that when we all get together and agree to believe that, you know, well, we're savage animals. Sometimes Kitty Genovese gets knifed and 37 people look out for themselves instead of doing something. If we all decide to agree that, yes, we will create a new god and he will be pretty terrible. Well, therefore, we gotta have an antibody to that kind of spiritual energy that's circulating these days that says that it's all hopeless and we might as well just be as sweetly decadent as we can manage. We're gonna need a new something. I hesitate to use the word religion because I know that's a raw nerve on all of us. That's a button with lots of connotations, and maybe there's no way we can even agree on what the word religion means. But it's the closest one I can find to what I mean. Now, what I mean by a religion is something that's absolutely seamless. No divisions with science and philosophy and with our law and with our psychology. They're all attempts to describe the universe, and they're all describing the same universe. So they all ought to come down to the same thing. Call it a religion, okay? And accept that I'm not talking about a guy with a white beard who's going to make us all cool. We need a new state of mind. How do we get a new state of mind? What do you do? How do you advertise a state of mind? Guess who bells the cat, folks? You and me. There ain't nobody else around. How do you do that? Well, okay, I can offer you one or two practical suggestions. I know of one guy who's running a regular class in how to survive on a starship. His name is Stephen Gaskin, and he runs a place down in Tennessee. I wouldn't even say he runs a place, but a place has formed around him in Summertown, Tennessee. He simply calls himself The Farm. I'm not going to let myself go into a commercial for The Farm because my own attitude toward it is ambivalent, as is my own attitude toward most of the spiritual movements I've seen in this country. But I will say this. What they're doing down there is trying to survive and get each other happy. Call it get each other stoned. They use hippie terminology. And not rip off the planet in any way that they can see. They grow all their own food. They make all their own stuff. They do their own housing. They take nothing from nobody. And the only way I can convey to you in a few words how well they're doing is to tell you that this is a community of approximately 800 or 900 long hairs, hippies, on 2,000 acres right in the middle of Redneck, Tennessee. And anywhere you go in the state of Tennessee, ask people on the street about Stevens Farm, and they'll smile and tell you how to get there. The local sheriff loves Stevens Farm because he can come to the gate and say, "We heard there's some runaways coming this way. Have you seen them?" And the guy on the gate will think and say, "No." And the sheriff can turn around and walk away. He doesn't have to go and search 2,000 acres of hippies. Because they tell the truth, they do good work, they give to the local community, they send food to Guatemala. Enough commercial. Stephen Gaskin, I've met the man, and it's my opinion that he's a telepath. He can meet you, be in your presence for about 5 seconds, hear maybe 3 or 4 words out of your mouth, and then he'll say a sentence, and that sentence will start change your life. Will get you thinking for the next 3 or 4 years of your every spare minute about that sentence. He's not a spiritual figure in the sense of Maharaji. No one worships him. He is not divine. He calls himself a teacher. He was away from the farm for 2 years on a time he spent in prison, and the farm ran fine without him. Okay, they're doing a workshop, and how do we survive on a starship? They got a thing there that takes nothing from nobody, and it puts out. And it worked for them. How'd they do it? Well, I just stumbled through a book called Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. Yeah. There's no sense even trying to sum up the book. I just want to read you a quick section here, the section where he gets to California after traveling across the country by motorcycle and realizes that the more people there are around, the lonelier they are. But you can tell when you've reached the coast when people stop being friendly. Technology is blamed for a lot of this loneliness, since the loneliness is certainly associated with the newer technological devices, TV, jets, freeways, and so on. But I hope it's been made plain in the course of this book that the real evil isn't the objects of technology, but the tendency people have to let technology isolate them into lonely attitudes of objectivity. It's the objectivity, the dualistic way of looking at things underlying technology, that produces the evil. That's why I went to so much trouble in this book to show how technology can be used to destroy the evil. A person who knows how to fix motorcycles with quality is less likely to run short of friends than one who doesn't. And they aren't going to see him as some kind of object either. Quality destroys objectivity every time. Or if he takes whatever dull job he's stuck with, and they all are sooner or later dull, and just to keep himself amused, starts to look for options of quality and secretly pursues those options just for their own sake, thus making an art out of what he's doing, he's likely to discover that he becomes a much more interesting person and much less of an object to the people around him, because his quality decisions change him too. And not only the job and him, but others too, because the quality tends to fan out like waves. The quality job that he didn't think anyone was going to see is seen. And the person who sees it feels a little better because of it and is likely to pass that feeling on to others. And in that way, the quality tends to keep on going. My personal feeling is that this is how any further improvement of the world will be done, by individuals making quality decisions, and that's all. God, I don't want to have any more enthusiasm for big programs full of social planning for big masses of people that leave individual quality out. These can be left alone for a while. There's a place for them, but they've got to be built on a foundation of quality within the individuals involved. We've had that individual quality in the past, exploited it as a natural resource without knowing it, and now it's just about depleted. Everybody's just out of gumption. We do need a return to individual integrity, self-reliance, and old-fashioned gumption. So says Robert M. Persig in Zen and Motorcycle Man. Stephen agrees. The primary tenet of his teaching is that you are responsible for your actions. You are ultimately responsible for your actions, and there ain't no behaviorist or any other rationalizer that can take it away from you. Every time you make a decision, you are functioning as the commander of the starship Earth. Every one of us. How do you do that sensibly? Okay, go back to the basics. Every time, look around you and realize that you are basic. You got to eat. Well, you got to pay attention to that then. You can't say life survives by going to the supermarket. Well, you have to defecate every day. So you can't. You better pay attention to that. You can't pull a lever and let that get taken care of, especially not if you live in New York. The black tide is creeping north. Okay? Everyone's probably heard that story by now. You got to go back to the basics of what you are and figure out how to take care of them and then go on from there. Every time it comes down to paying attention. Whatever it is that you're doing right now, paying attention to it and doing it as well, as creatively, as artistically as you can. You got to emit quality. Stephen says you got to follow the Zen ideal. You must strive at all times to be impeccable. Pretty good won't do. Well, it will do, because that's what we're going to get, because we're not going to be impeccable, let's face it. But if you're looking for pretty good, and you're willing to settle for what we laughingly brought up as the theme of this panel before we started, inspired mediocrity, you're not going to do it. Every time, go back to the basics and pay attention. Once you do this, you will discover that there is something superior to pleasure. My favorite world of tomorrow is one in which we keep pleasure, but bear in mind the joy has a much longer half-life. It's much more satisfying. It costs more to get. Somehow or other, I grew up in this culture with the notion, I don't know how many of you did, but I absorbed the impression that the smart man avoids hard work at any cost. That hard work is for the suckers. Some guys are so dumb they gotta dig ditches, man. Some guys are so dumb they gotta chop their own wood to survive. But the smart ones figure out some way to get a robot to do it for them, and then they turn their attention to the finer things of life, like the theater and the opera and the ballet. I chop my own wood to survive, and it's the most satisfying feeling in the world. I've noticed after 25, 28 years, it's finally dawned on me that that cultural thing that they gave me that said that you should strive to be lazy was wrong, that everything that I've ever had that was worth a damn thing cost me a lot of hard work. Well, with hard work, we can get joy. We can get sharing. We can get telepathy. I believe that Stephen is a telepath, having met him, and he tells me that the way he got to it was by way of empathy. This is the underlying message behind my first novel, that empathy squared equals telepathy. Stephen said, there's 90% of the brain that they don't know what that's for, right? And all us science fiction fans cherish the secret hope that someday they'll figure out the chemical that will unlock that section of the brain and we'll all be telepaths and we'll be able to teleport our beer cans to our hands. Man, that 90% is there, and I'm told that it will do all that stuff. And I am told by a man whose opinion I respect that the way that you get there is to shovel out the communications room. Shovel all the shit out of the communications room. The communications room, he says, is your own subconscious. that when you are at peace with yourself and your signal-to-noise ratio gets a little better, when you get relaxed and you start paying attention, you discover that you are a telepath and you always were. You're just too busy to pay attention. Once we get that kind of sharing, we'll all learn. It won't take walking into Callahan's bar to learn that these three things, that shared pain gets lessened, that shared joy gets increased, and that truly shared pleasure, not pleasure that took place in the same bed with someone, but shared pleasure can bring joy, and that's the way it gets there. In summation, I can only say God is dead. We must be about the business of electing his successor. We're late. Now, the last time around, we elected a bearded war hero, a widower with one son, and a very mysterious Secretary of State called the Holy Spirit. This time around, in light of what we now know, and for lack of any other eligible candidate, I nominate you and me, science fiction fans. Let's save the world.
Following our apotheosis, we can continue with the panel. Thank you, Spatter. I am going to talk for a minute about the art of projecting futures, which is something I know something about. Excuse me a moment. I seem to have sprained my voice. Is that an empty glass, and may I have it? Yeah, that's a clean one. Thank you very much. Excuse me. This has truly been the busiest convention I was ever at, and I ended up having a meeting with a publisher last night at 3 in the morning or something. All right. If you're trying to predict the future, it turns out to be easy to do 200 years from now than 50 years from now. The reason for that is that 200 years from now, certain things will have happened. I'm not precisely sure when they will have taken place. In 200 years, we're either going to be off of this particular spaceship and onto a lot of others, exploit the fact that we do not live on only one Earth, which to me is not merely the most pessimistic, but the stupidest rallying cry I've ever heard. But on 9 planets, 34 moons, and about 500,000 asteroids, for starters. Since this is a panel on my favorite world of tomorrow, we got there. For if we did not, we won't be having world science fiction conventions then. God knows what will be happening. We might be back to stones and clubs. Now, when, I don't know precisely. I can give you scenarios. And the scenarios I can give you are called the surprise-free type of projection. That is to say, you just lay things out, look at them as a logical sequence, and you do not assume that any vast surprises will happen to you. But of course, while that is the most probable single event, it is very improbable that that one comes about. Do you understand what I mean? If I throw a pair of dice, the most probable single event is a 7. But it is improbable that the 7 will be the first thing you roll. For if that were not the case, you would never lose at Las Vegas. So the surprise-free projection, although the most probable single event, is not the projection that will probably happen. Something else will. The trouble is, because it contains, by definition, surprises, we don't know what they are. My projection is the shuttle does go. We are successful in containing the efforts of a large portion of the Congress to take the shuttle and turn it from salaries. Basically, the question is, do you pay the salaries to engineers or do you pay the salaries to the graduates of sociology departments?
Are those not the real two choices as to what's to happen with tax money? The choice that will not happen is that they will leave it in your pocket and let you decide what to do with it. Now, on theoretical grounds, I might say that perhaps that you know, it would be better if they did that. But since they are not going to, it is senseless to work towards it. If the shuttle goes, we get access to orbit. Once you have access, and I mean access, not merely to the government, but to the large corporations, and even to you and me, you may not be aware that NASA has planned one shuttle mission, which is full of boxes on the order of 6 feet by 2 feet by 2 feet. And if you can come up with an experiment that will fit into one of those boxes that must be done in zero gravity, they will be happy to hear from you. You can get a larger box, too. Basically, they're advertising to the scientific community that here is available some space in a zero-G environment, and you figure out what you want to do with it, which probably turns out to be a pretty good idea, rather than having somebody sit there and strain like a gearbox and try to come up with it all. Because, you know, even though I know everything, it turns out that sometimes I overlook a few details. If that happens, in my judgment, looking at the results that Harry Gatos got at the University of Maryland in the Skylab experiments, there are going to be so many profits made from space environment that that's the end of the game. You will not be able to restrict access to it. I'm sure all of you have heard my pessimistic scenario in which it doesn't happen, and the next thing we know, we discover we have to go to space, but we can't get there anymore. But this is my optimistic one. Once we have got those orbiting laboratories and the moon base, I do not know whether Mr. Henson's L5 business will work, or if we turn Venus into a place to live, and Mars into a place to live, or both, all three. I do know that we will play about with bringing in metals from the asteroids. We will do something about a great deal of the industrial pollution of this Earth simply by doing the most pollution costly operations off of it. I have heard a few, I hesitate to use the word fool, I have heard a few misguided people yell at me about polluting outer space. I'm sure I don't really need to tell you people, I want half of that, by the way, Spotter. I'm sure I don't need to tell you that if we were to endeavor to make it the life work of mankind, and we were to devote the entire gross world product over and above what it takes to keep us alive to the pollution of outer space, we would not be very successful. With the best work effort we could manage, we might manage to pollute the area between here and the moon a little bit. So, if that happens, we will have removed from this Earth a number of its burdens. What the result of that would be, in terms of the resources available to us, would be splendid. In terms of its effects on our lives, they will be profound. And in addition to profound, I think pleasurable. It is lately that we can afford to be pessimistic, in a sense. I find it in some respects a little strange that people who got to Kansas City, Kansas, in a matter of hours, are talking about the evils of technology, and I've heard some of that, if you do not see what I mean, that we are no longer free because technology enslaves us, when I will point out that you would not have been free to be here if it were not for the airplane that could do it. Missouri, sorry.
Sorry.
Yes, and to make it worse, I have a perfectly good atlas. My point is that what you do with the choices is something else. But it is only with modern industrial technology that you get any choices to begin with. You may not care for some of them. How many of you are willing to pay 50,000 lives a year in order to have a personal transportation system? Took you a minute to think about it, didn't it? How many of you... I see. How many of you are willing to give up personal transportation systems to save 50,000 lives a year? Do any of those with their hands up now own cars? About a third of you. Are you going to sell them tomorrow morning? Because, of course, the automobile does cost 50,000 lives a year. Now, that may be a misuse of this piece of technology, but it seems to be a rather constant price that we are going to pay for it. Not deliberately planned, but it is going to happen. And you tell me, I'm sure, that you can think of dozens of improvements to it. The dozens of improvements to it do not turn out to be terribly popular. Now, I can solve that problem for you. I can build you something and tell you you will ride it or else. At the moment, we have moved in this country towards, I think, more maximization of real freedom in a meaningful sense than any outfit ever did in history. You may find that surprising. Gosh, they were free to smoke hashish in Arabia 50, 100 years ago, and we're not. Maybe not, but they were also free to do nothing else, to take 25 days to go from Baghdad to Mecca, to never see any place else to live, to ride camels as the only means of getting from one place to another. We may not be free to smoke pot, except that it's easy enough to get away with it, but we are free to travel across the country in a matter of hours, to eat a variety of foods in the middle of winter, to have teeth at nearly age 50. I'm self-destructed, so, you know, we are an organism designed to self-destruct in around age 40. Think about it, are we not? You know, from the point of view of primitive beings, the best thing that can happen is that as soon as your kids are old enough themselves to have kids, you ought to have the decency to get out of the way and die. We have thwarted that, and thank God. But we have done it by interfering with the natural order of events. That state to the west of us that I thought we were in is full of wheat. We could turn it back to its natural environment, which is buffalo grass and buffalo, and let, what, in the order of 50 million people starve to death? Those are real alternatives. In my judgment, the same thing will be true for the next 50 years that has been true for the last 50. In the last 50 years, we have gone from a point to a point at which the not merely the common citizen in the sense of a statistical average, but the least wealthy of us, the least influential of us, has available riches that the various kings of the world could not have bought but would have given everything they owned to obtain 50 years ago. And in my judgment, that is my picture of the future. I do not know precisely what the options will be for those of us who survive the next 50 years. Many of you, probably not me. But I can tell you that 50 years from now, there is nothing that the wealthiest man on this planet can have that every one of you cannot have. And not merely every one of you, but I think every person on this globe. Certainly, we will be in 50 years to the point where the poorest savage on this globe will have available to them what you had available to you, say, 10 years ago. That is what technology will do for us. It may do much to us. Because in my judgment, technology is thoroughly neutral with regard to what you do with it. And the eternal questions of mankind have been around a long damn time. They boil down to one and one only. Whom do the warriors obey? And that one we haven't solved. And that one perhaps Spider addresses to better than I do. I can tell you what your options are, and I can tell you to something about how we might try to get to them. But when it comes to the study of exactly what is your relationship to your masters, and your masters are those persons whom you employ to fight for you, your individual rights exist only so long as when you pick up the telephone, somebody in blue will come and do something about them. I find it very interesting that the one thing nobody seems to have thought about in a Genovese case is that nobody called the cops. And that's what they're all talking about. Nobody called the cops. It never occurs to them that we have at least got a situation in which if somebody had, something would have been done. That, it seems to me, is worth something. That, it seems to me, is worth something. And I think the most frightening world you could get to is the one in which you don't have the option of calling the police, or when you do, nothing will happen. I will wind this up. I will talk about three things in the technological field that impinge upon what previous speakers have said. Adam Reed at Rockefeller University is working now on cracking the code in here. That is the method by which your brain communicates to the outside world and vice versa. At the moment, the system is information inefficient, although very efficient in terms of its design function. At the moment, to get information into your head, you have to use these rather highly specialized sensors that we carry about, eyes and ears, which were not designed to transfer enormous amounts of pre-sorted information, if you see what I mean. Your eyes give you an incredible number of bits of information. Think about it for a minute. Instead of relaxing and enjoying it, just think of what you were seeing when you look, including the periphery and the rest of it, and think of just how many billions of data points you are able to observe at this point. But they are not set up to take organized information and squirt it through fast, precisely because their function is to take disorganized information and sort out of it those factors that you want to pay attention to right now. Do you see what I mean? If we can crack that communication code that goes on in here, and Rockefeller University thinks that the first... At the moment, to get information into your head, you have to use these rather highly specialized sensors that we carry about, eyes and ears, which were not designed to transfer enormous amounts of pre-sorted information, if you see what I mean. Your eyes give you an incredible number of bits of information. Think about it for a minute. Instead of relaxing and enjoying it, just think of what you were seeing when you look, including the periphery and the rest of it, and think of just how many billions of data points you are able to observe at this point. But they are not set up to take organized information and squirt it through fast, precisely because their function is to take disorganized information and sort out of it those factors that you want to pay attention to right now. Do you see what I mean? If we can crack that communication code that goes on in here, and Rockefeller University thinks that the first successful experiments in this range may take place within 10 years, it will be physically possible to take the contents of a book and squirt it into your head in something between 10 seconds and 100 minutes. Direct communication from the outside world to the inside in the sense of organized information passing from one to the other. The implications of that are rather high, are they not? Education as we think of it ceases to exist at that point, does it not? Education as we think of it just does not exist any longer. The old hickory stick and the teacher and the rest of it doesn't happen. Education might, for a change, consist in trying to teach you how to do something with the contents of your head and not merely to try to drill a hole in it and pour some kerosene, and pour the information in. That would be, I think, a beneficial change, and it impinges upon what both Arson and Spider were talking about. Within the biofeedback movement, Barbara Brown recently told me that she is quite convinced that there is nothing that was done by the various Eastern mystics that it actually has been done, as opposed to many of the claims, such things as very long suspended animation, that type of thing. That none of those remarkable feats that have been accomplished by the Eastern mystics is beyond the reach of most of us within a few years with the help of the biofeedback system, which lets you learn how to control your own nervous system. You do not have to spend years contemplating your navel to learn how to make your hand temperature fall, for I can do it now. I can, to some extent, even control the bleeding of slight cuts. Now, it is a matter just of getting the right sensors and then trying it until it works, and you keep trying it till it works, and after a while you learn what you did. It's like learning to wiggle your ears. Once you know how to do it, it's simple. Until you know how to do it, you don't know how to do it. But you can learn it by looking in a mirror. And in a sense, the biofeedback movement is a method of providing you with mirrors so that you can learn how to wiggle your internal ears. I know people, I am not one of them, who can get one hand warm and the other cold. And that type of thing. I use the relaxation techniques a lot, which is why that I seem as indestructible as I am in these conventions. Because actually 3 or 4 minutes sitting down in a chair with complete relaxation will beat hell out of an hour of attempted sleep, especially with if you're on the pool deck as we are. So, I don't know if what I've said makes sense, although I think it does. And what I am trying to wrap up here is, yeah, there are a lot of things that can happen to us, and some of them are likely to be pretty good. But I want to close with a story, because I fear that it is the best illustration of what your future will be like. And the story is about a lecture at California Institute of Technology. This is, in a sense, the high priest of the technological world, right? Whether you say Caltech or MIT, certainly one or the other of them is up there at the top, huh? This is a lecture on computer technology, which has got to be one of the subjects towards the edge of the technological expanding sphere. By the way, I want to correct a foul canard. Certainly in the part of California in which I live, you do not find that friendship and smiles stop when you get there. The place that I find terrifying is New York City, where I've been able to go for 5 days without anybody having say good morning to me. Well, you may hiss at me, but if any of you had that experience, I was 5 days in that city and no one said good morning to me, not even the people who I was paying money to serve me and so forth. But leave us not get into regional chauvinisms. Because there is a point to what I'm saying regarding the lecture at Caltech. The lecture was to have been given by a professor, but instead was being given by his graduate student, a common experience. The graduate student, unfortunately, did not speak English very well, another common situation. To make it worse, it was in a large lecture theater. To make it worse, the graduate student himself had an assistant who was going about putting little signs. They had, in fact, a computer setup complete on the stage, and this was to be in a lecture illustrated with actual operations. But when the chap went about putting the various signs up onto the pieces of equipment, as the other guy lectured in his very broken English so that nobody understood what he was saying anyway, the signs kept falling off so that nobody could see which piece of equipment he was talking about. Yet the computer did everything it was supposed to exactly. And I will put it to you that possibly your best projection of the future is it's going to be technologically efficient, it's going to work marvelously, it will do most of what you want it to do, but it will still be sloppy.
Oh.
Okay, on our format, we will now have remarks by Mr. Bain, who has not prepared, but will discuss what has previously been said. We will have each of the panelists have a brief statement if they wish to, and then we will take questions from the floor. Jim Bain.
I think we've heard here a rather curious dichotomy between a sort of spiritual occult value oriented favorite future on the one side and a technologically oriented achievement oriented future, material achievement oriented future on the other. And I've almost sensed a hidden assumption that there is something mutually exclusive between these. And I really don't think it is. In fact, I think that in large part, the something that is close to a spiritual awakening that I think is happening in this country. Certainly the degree of excitement in the response to Spider's talk and Arson's implies that has been made possible in large part by the very technology that has been sort of downplayed. I would like to direct myself to one statement that Spider made. Spider is a personal friend, so when I say that I felt personally affronted by it, Spider, I'm sure you'll understand, right, buddy? And that is that we're on this here spaceship, and ethically speaking, we can't get off it and leave the rest of the inhabitants to their fate. First off, I would like to point out that this spaceship has some resemblance to a lifeboat, and there's been many a time that only the brave jumped off that lifeboat, and they did so because it was sinking, because there were too many people on it. But before that analogy breaks down, as it no doubt could, I'd like to point out, I think Jerry said it implicitly, but I'd like to state it right out, that to get the kind of technology necessary for really getting out there, out past Pluto, out to the stars, to become, as Mr. Heinlein said, the men of the stars, I won't try my Latin either. The first stage in developing this starfaring technology is developing a solar system technology. The kind of solar system technology that Jerry Pournelle has discussed at some length in Galaxy, among other places. This is only going to happen one way, that is if it pays off. Now, paying off means that there will be a lot, well, to use a word that has unfortunate connotations, profit. Now, what profit means, basically, is that there will be more things for more people because of that technology. If that technology is developed, there'll be more food, there'll be less dirt, there will be more energy per capita. Without that technology, there will be less. To develop a full-flung solar system technology is something to be devoutly hoped for, and nothing any of us need feel ethically ashamed if we work toward this achievement. And I guess that's where I'll stop talking because I really wasn't prepared.
Arson, do you have anything to add before we ask for questions? Carl? Spider?
Yeah, let me jump in with a couple. Here we go. I agree with Jim. We need solar system technology, and we need it soon. The thing is, if we're going to do it, we're going to have to approach it right as good engineers. And that projected death ratios that you work up every time you work up engineering specs, that's sloppy right now. So far, our engineering in that direction is terrible because we're going to lose a lot of folks on the way to Pluto. That's the area we got to tighten up. At the moment,
Sure, sir.
Sure, but you must not do these as absolute figures.
No.
If you are projecting, let us say, for instance, that we are talking about a dam, and I can project that that 25 people will die if I do it, that's a lot of people. But I may also well be able to project that within the next 30 years, 5,000 people will be killed by a flood in that valley if I do not build it.
Yeah.
Those are the numbers that must be compared.
Right on.
It's very easy to come up with numbers that'll scare the hell out of you, and I suspect Mr. Darnay and I may get into an argument on this in a little bit, because if you ask the absolute question about almost anything, let's take something deliberately controversial, nuclear power plants. You ask the question, are they safe? The answer is very simple, no. The question is, are they safer than the only reasonable alternatives? That question is debatable, and I will not attempt to answer it. But until you ask the right question, there is no point in continuing the discussion. And yet, here. And I will give it back to you now, but my problem is that I see all too many debates around the wrong question entirely.
Oh. One quick point. I have some friends who were either for or against that famous proposition in California about nuclear power. I am not a cult figure opposed to nuclear power. Never have been, never will be.
Okay. Hear, hear. Okay, I just wanted to throw in a couple more things. One, I agree with Jerry that I don't think we're going to pollute space significantly. But the reason why I feel that may differ slightly from his, I'm not sure. I was talking before about the basics that we just got to know to properly plan, okay? The basics you got to remember and make sure you design that into the system or it don't work. Like, we got to die and we got to eat and we got to pass wastes and that stuff, okay? Those are the basics that speak to the issue of pollution. There are other basics, you know, we got to make love and socialize, but that's between us. In terms of reacting with the environment, right now, when you die, society does its damnedest to make sure that you never re-enter the ecology, or that if you do, you do so as air pollution. And we make no effort at all to, you know, we got to learn how to return our books to the library, put stuff back where we found it. And until we do that, we'll be polluting. I think that by the time we get to space, just in order to get smart enough to get there, we're going to have to learn to be better housekeepers. And that'll take care of itself. Just want to underline one more time the thing that I keep feeling in my mind, that Jerry was talking about, you know, that driving an automobile, you're getting a transportation system at a cost of 50,000 lives a year. There's probably one guy somewhere who probably isn't here because he's a science fiction fan, because he isn't a science fiction fan, even though he needs to be. But there's probably one guy somewhere, one automotive engineer, or maybe the engineer doesn't have the power. Maybe it's the money man who pulls his strings and tells him what to do. Some guy somewhere could make a quality decision and cut as many as, you know, 10 or 20,000 lives off that 50,000 annual death cost. I don't know who he is or what that decision is that he could maybe make that would make automobiles safer, but some guy could have done it and didn't.
I can do it.
You can do it by using your car sanely.
I can do it. Well, no, I don't mean by using my car sanely. It was done. There was an attempt a few years ago to sell the cars on the grounds of safety. That's one reason why one of the big three is no longer very big. Nobody bought the damn things.
Yeah, it happens because the...
I mean, now, I can do it. All you've got to do is give me dictatorial powers over what you will be permitted to drive, and I will see to it that you will have an automobile in which you can't be hurt. You will spend, of course, a large fraction of your lifetime gross earnings paying for it.
Yeah.
But if that is what you tell me that you really, really want, we can do it for you if you want to pay for it. But you know something? I'll bet you'll be one of the first guys not to buy it. I'll bet you'd rather have a 10 Lizzie.
Maybe, maybe not. Don't know. I know that if everybody wanted one, it'd be cheap. And
not true. Not true. Cheaper.
Cheaper.
Three times as much
cheaper
steel
for
can
sure.
be cheaper.
I'm sorry if I keep coming back to the fact that most arguments in the last analysis are put as if they were qualitative, and they are not. Most of them are quantitative. And one of the things that scares the liver out of me is so damn few people can add up two or three numbers and look at the results.
Yeah, I got friends in Nova Scotia who refuse to believe the figures that say that, you know, as you said in your column, that the decision makers are going to decide between nuclear power or coal, and that's the two choices. There are so many people that I know that still beat their head against the wall and say, no, I don't know the figures, and I can't be bothered to look them up, but I know we could all build windmills if we really tried.
Sure.
That ain't going to work. The one thing I want to say is just now I fell into my own trap that I've been talking about, and I said one guy could make a quality decision and that would take care of it. That's not true. Jerry's right. Nobody can impose this upon anybody. But that quantitative thing, that 30 million people deciding that they'd like to have a quality automobile and they're willing to pay for it, well, you know, each of you is a voting member. The tendency of our age is to convince you that you're a meaningless unit, that you just disappear in the statistical mass, and to the extent that you believe that, it's true. And to the extent that you refuse to believe it, you're a free man and you're building a free race. One man, you right there, right now, you can make a quality decision not to drive your car while you're drunk, and that'll save six lives. The maximum number of people that could have been stuffed in the car you would have hit drunk. And just keep multiplying that and we're okay. The only way to get that across, to make people make them quality decisions, is to just live a life in which you make as many quality decisions as you can and advertise by example. That's the only thing in the world that's going to do it. You can't write good sense into a syllabus so that it can be preached by someone disinterested to someone else disinterested and have them wake up. You're going to have to show them.
Yeah, may I comment on that? Because that's what he has said is very important. Those of you who are familiar with my stories know that I have possibly some minor affection for aristocracies. What may or may not always come clear in them is that I have absolutely no love for exclusive aristocracies. It's very easy to be an aristocrat. Very easy in one sense, very hard in another. All it requires is a willingness to accept the responsibility you just incurred. You might find a lot of people who don't. Now, aristocracies traditionally have run through families for a very simple reason. The family structure holds together or can hold together long enough to produce somebody who really does understand something about taking responsibility, the consequences of what they do. But John Adams said a long time ago in this country that, you know, any man who influences more votes than his own is an aristocrat. That is a more profound statement than you may think it is. And in one sense, the science fiction community has a hell of an advantage over a lot of others. We are, in a sense, a family. We can learn from each other if we take the decision to do it. You know, the 400 or 500 people here in this room, if you acted together on a number of the things we've been talking about today, you might not believe the amount of influence that you could have. It is quite powerful. Well, it is sufficiently so that, I mean, even the attraction thereof was sufficiently so that, as I think I told you, NASA offered to route the TV signal that went to the White House from JPL through here. We weren't able to take advantage of it, insufficient technology and technological resources. But I find it heartening and encouraging that they were willing to do it, that they thought enough of you to be willing to do that at some cost in time and trouble, particularly in the time of some very highly paid and very highly competent people who were willing to do that for us. Part of the problem, there were things that I guess what I'm trying. People who are willing to accept the job. If none of the other panelists have something to say, we will entertain questions. Yes, sir. You'll have to speak up. I'm mildly deaf.
People I've talked to here and elsewhere that we as a civilization are fast approaching a turning point in our history, a certain point of no return. We have nowhere to go but up or down. I'd like to have your comments about what we as individuals can do to influence people who have the power to make the right decisions, and how should we go about doing this?
who'd like to attack that? I have obviously expressed myself on that subject in a column called Blueprint for Survival that was in, what, the July Galaxy, or perhaps it was the April one, but in that July Galaxy.
Would you repeat the question, please?
The question was, since it does seem to be a remarkable consensus among people here that we are at a major choice point in the history of mankind, that is a consensus opinion which I certainly share, namely that we're either going to go up and out or down and out, what can you, all of us, do about this to try to influence the course of the world in the direction that we would like to see it go?
I'll jump in if it's okay, Jerry. This strikes right home because just last night I listened to a man who I regard as one of the best extrapolators now living stand up and say, there are going to be wars. Don't kid yourself. And this morning I woke up to an ear-splitting peal of thunder. So the thing has been on my mind all morning. You know, what can I do? What have I been doing wrong that maybe could have been better? All I can come up with, what works for what I try and do, is budget a lot of time to sit down and relax and clear my head, put aside the distractions, and find out how have I been blowing it lately? How can I be the best Spider Robinson that I can be? And then if I go out and I do that and the world goes to hell and blows up anyway and I die, well, you know, what more could I have done?
Maybe a lot, Spider. Maybe that's part of the problem.
Depends on how deep you examine the question. Be the best one you can be.
I'd like it.
Let me come.
Everybody wants it.
All right, we have...
I'll make it short.
There is a story that I read in a novel. I forget the novel now, but it was not a science fiction book. About the man who was in command of Sweden during the 30 Years' War. And the story has it that a beautifully made box was made available to him when he was not yet the ruler of the country. He placed the box in one of his two estates, and the box was so beautiful that the room looked ugly. So he rebuilt the room because it had to fit the box. And after a while, the room looked so nice that the house didn't look too good, and so he had to rebuild the house. After that, the grounds looked kind of tawdry compared to the house. He had to redo the grounds. And so the story goes that eventually he, by working one step at a time, he had to get to rule Sweden in order to accommodate the county in which his house was, and so forth and so on. The message of the story, obviously, is that probably the best way to influence the world is not to look toward the guys in power, because that's the old thing you're always told, is write to your congressman, influence others, and so forth. I really liked Spider's comment that you should make quality decisions of your own. If you do make quality decisions of your own, then presumably you'll go through the same process, and you'll transform the world around you. And that is bound to have some benefit. If not, after all, there's always death.
I'd like to be the walking cliche who tells you you can indeed write your congressman. But there's something else to do first. Oh, yes. Well, you know, writing your congressman can indeed get your congressman to write back to you and tell you that because of the letter he read in Galaxy and that had been sent forwarded to him by one of the people in his district, he had introduced a bill in Congress to allocate acreage for the production of jojoba, a plant whose oils are remarkably similar to those of the sperm whale. And I think that's probably an achievement which is far more Jerry's than mine, but I was very pleased to have a part in it.
In fact, can I try an experiment? How many of you are familiar with what we're talking about? How many of you actually took the trouble to send that copy of that column to your congressman? That's not a bad picture of the proportions, but the results are astounding. It may happen. There is actually, there was allocated another $500,000 for the study of this project this year, I think largely due to your efforts. So may I congratulate you people who did send that article. It turns out you didn't waste your time. Thank you. Yeah.
Man, I said it before, I'll say it again. If you, them politician guys, they'll do whatever they think the most votes want. If you want right things and you want them hard enough so that it becomes apparent to your neighbor that that sounds like a smart thing to want, you'll get what you're asking for, man. We threw out a president, okay?
Okay.
For the first time in the history of the world, the most efficient propaganda machine ever. Maybe it's not the first time. I don't know enough about history to say that. But for the first time in the history that I've been exposed to by my, quote, education, unquote, for the first time, enough people got together and defeated the greatest propaganda machine ever assembled, the most technologically efficient control mechanism. We said, no, we ain't going to have no war. Now, there's still war going on, but that one ain't happening. We've achieved a partial success. If you keep on putting out what you want, you'll get it. One minor horse I'd like to jump on right here. Germane to this issue, I'm rather astonished that, well, I'm told that something like 2,500 or 3,000 of us came here, okay? They were expecting 6 to 10, we got about 3. We did not get 3,000 Yugo votes. Those of you who didn't vote, you got no kick coming if the science fiction that comes out next year isn't what you wanted to see and doesn't spread whatever you wanted to spread. It's up to you, it's in your hands. You know, if the convention's in Tanganyika, for $3 you can make your voice heard. For a 10-cent stamp, a 13-cent stamp, 15-cent stamp, whatever it is next week, you can tell the nice congressman what you want. You're not a statistical non-entity. Do it.
I had just one other bite I wanted to take out of that question, which was that perhaps the most important thing to do is to get clear in your own mind what you think should be done. Become clear on what the questions are, what the options are, and what your opinion as to right action is. Then, yes, indeed, you can write your congressman or other persons you feel to be in control of power, Nexi. But somewhere between Spider and Jerry, once you get yourself clear on these things, you can tell the people around you. And that's how you build snowballs. And that's really what I want to say.
Hear, hear. I just got to throw something in there, though, because this may be some practical advice that may help you. I just spent a year living in a spiritual community in Nova Scotia, okay? At the end of that year, communications totally broke down. They asked me to leave because the general feeling was that writing science fiction wasn't spiritual enough. So therefore, it's manifest that somehow or other I wasn't very good at telling my neighbor what I thought was far out, and somehow I wasn't very good at living it. Telling it is always subject to the connotative effects of the words and like that. Now, once I was in a hospital, and I was at a turning point in my life because I'd gone through some heavy experiences, like St. Paul getting knocked off the horse, and I met a man. Now, this man had been on a rescue squad for the local fire department, and one day he was taking the rescue van back into the garage, and a 2-ton garage door cut loose, come down on the cab, killed his partner outright. And he, from here down, was mostly plastic bags and tubes and things that make a colostomy bag look like a tin Lizzie. His pleasures were exactly two. He had a TV set that he couldn't afford to pay for and didn't rate. And every day he had pell-mell cigarettes to smoke that just appeared magically on his bed table without him paying for them. He was broke. He was shattered. He had nothing left in the way of pleasure. And so he had turned to joy. This man's name, cosmically enough, was John Smiley, and John Smiley was the most joyful man I have ever met in my life. He was just a beam of radiance, of joy. The whole hospital loved him. He had helped the supervisor of the hospital kick Demerol. He had helped a nurse when her child died. He just spread joy by example, made